The season of Lent is a deeply personal time for Christians. In these 40 days of preparation, we reflect on our sinfulness before God. Yet in this repentance, there is an unmistakable joyfulness and hope, as our reflection also turns to Christ our Redeemer. Our close attention on Christ's story of ministry, leading to death on the cross and ultimately resurrection on Easter, is the chief aspect of our reflection during this time. For it is Christ alone whose redeeming work keeps us in the family of saints, despite our own great weaknesses. Under the leadership of staff accompanist Dr. Heejung Shin, the Concordia Music Department presents a sacred recital under the theme of Christ alone. We pray that our service of music, combined with the Word of God and spoken reflections, provides you with a helpful outlet for your own personal reflection, particularly in these times that are absent of live music ministry in many churches. May God bless you this season.
In many ways, our God is a God of paradoxes, at least to us. He acts in ways that go against our natural inclinations as humans, and he carries out his will in ways that we cannot understand. Things that are weak and lowly and forgotten to us are strong and mighty and loved in the eyes of our God. This paradox was present one faithful day on a hill far away, where an old rugged cross stood. I can imagine the thoughts of the people present that day as they witnessed that man on the cross. He had lost. It was over. There was no coming down from there. They probably expected him to beg for their forgiveness and confess his sins, and yet he calls out. He calls out to his Father and asks him to forgive them. What a confusing sight. He is the one who should be asking for their forgiveness, and what makes him think that the Father will actually listen to the prayer of such a broken man on a cross? It was only a matter of time before he would eventually die. The time was so close that they cast lots for his clothes soaked in the stains of his immense pain, but they didn't know. They didn't know that these rags they played with belonged to the one who could give them clothes that would never decay. They didn't know that these blood-soaked garments were worn by the only one who could clothe them with the glory of the Father. They didn't know that that same glory that was present with Adam and Eve before the fall rested on the head that bore the crown of thorns. And they didn't know that they could also catch a glimpse of this glory if they only believed. The fact that anything worthwhile came out of this shameful death on a cross is the greatest evidence of God's magnificent paradox. This paradox is found in the words of one of my favorite hymns, The Old Rugged Cross. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. This imagery is breathtaking in its simple beauty. The idea of clinging to an old rugged cross, stained with blood, a symbol of suffering and pain, and trading it in one day for a crown made of gold that we cannot even imagine, is one that can do nothing but fill us with joy and comfort. You see, the paradox of this story is that that man on the cross, who appeared to be in no position to save anything, offered this beautiful glory to a thief next to him. I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. This man who had been tortured and broken somehow had the power and authority to offer a place in paradise and to do so with all the truth that exists in our universe. And this is the promise of God to us. He gives us a place in paradise despite our unfaithfulness, despite our flaws, despite our weaknesses. All we need to do is proclaim, like the thief on the cross, that we have seen a glimpse of God's only Son and that we believe. And this paradox associated with the man on the cross becomes a thing of beauty. And who is this man? This man is God Himself, incarnate, our Savior, Christ alone.
He was despised and rejected. He was a man of suffering, familiar with pain, acquainted with grief. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our sin. Upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns. Thank you.
A mother sits, contemplating her situation as a parent. She finds herself constantly comparing her experiences as a mother to those around her, but she always felt as though that she was an outsider. She never thought she could relate to anyone else about what she's gone through. She looks at her son with tremendous compassion and deep love as she watches him toddle from one end of the room to the other. "What have I gotten myself into?" she asks herself. As the young boy grows up, his mother begins to notice that he displays a level of intelligence the likes of which she has never seen in someone his age. She knows who he is. The love this mother has for her son is powerful. The unique situation that she finds herself in seems to bring her even closer to him. There are many moments where she does not understand her son's actions, ideas, or teachings, but those moments never push her away. As she sees that her son is gaining significant notoriety and followers because of his religious teachings, she becomes proud, but nervous. We see the nerves of the mother come to a head when this revolutionary teacher is rejected by the religious leaders. He is rejected with such a level of passion that the religious leaders want him dead. Not only do they want him dead, but they want to make an example out of him. And so they did. And this mother is forced to watch the kid whom she raised, she fed, she taught to speak, the one she watched take his first steps and she held when he cried, get beaten, mocked, and hung on a cross. She had to watch her son cry, yet she could not hold him. Her son, while struggling to breathe, says goodbye to his mother. He offers his mother a new son, one of his followers. The son says goodbye to his mother as he himself endures abandonment of a different kind. As he hangs there, he endures the abandonment from God that you and I earned. He suffers not only the physical pain of puncture wounds and suffocation, but the spiritual pain of separation from his heavenly Father. He cries out the words of the psalmist, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Our Lord was glorified on that grim day. He was lifted up on a hill and separated from all that he loved. But that which he said to his mother, he says to all of us. Even in the darkest of moments, our Lord Jesus gives us an ember of hope. On that dark day, our Lord Jesus Christ said goodbye, but not farewell.
Would The final words of Jesus are recorded in the Gospels of John and Luke. In John 19:28, we read, "Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scriptures would be fulfilled, Jesus said, 'I am thirsty.'" In John 19:30, we read that when he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Finally, in Luke 23:46, we are told that Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. I want to end with the very last words, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." But to get there, I think we have to make sense of the two sayings that come before, "I am thirsty," and then immediately after, "It is finished." Now, I don't know about you, but this seems to me just to be a little odd. It's certainly not what I would have expected Jesus' last words to have been. Here we are, in the crucifixion. It's one of the most dramatic moments in human history. The Son of God is dying on a tree, and the gospel writers feel that it's important to tell us that Jesus' throat was dry and that he needed a drink. It's a strange thing. Yet, as is usually the case, this makes a lot more sense if we try to understand some of the things that have happened earlier in the story. In Luke 22, Jesus is celebrating his Last Supper with his disciples. This is the last meal that he will eat before he's handed over to the authorities and ultimately takes up the cross. The whole meal is of great significance, but I want to focus specifically on something that Luke tells us about in verse 18. Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." I will not drink the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. When I first read this, and you probably did too, I assume that this is, you know, talking about that great heavenly feast that Jesus will celebrate with his disciples and all of us on the last day. Certainly, that's where the kingdom comes. But as we learn in John, this isn't what Jesus is talking about. In John, as Jesus is dying on the cross, we are told that Jesus, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, said, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine stood there, so they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it in his mouth. When he had received the sour wine, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. It is here on the cross that Jesus again drinks the fruit of the vine. It's here on the cross, when Jesus is dying for you and for me, and all is completed, it's here on the cross that the kingdom of God finally comes. And this is not like an earthly kingdom. The king does not lord his power over his subjects. Instead, he joins those subjects, and he becomes the lowest among them, taking on the form of a servant, and he goes so far as even to die for them. Not just to die, but to die a shameful, humiliating death on the cross. This is no earthly kingdom. The final words of Jesus are recorded in Luke 23:46. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. In this moment, Jesus calls out to God with complete faith and trust. And in doing so, he finally shows us what all of this means. It means that despite our sin, despite our evil, despite this world, this kingdom of fear and sin and death, we can still trust in God, knowing that his love conquers all things, even ourselves, because he did not spare his own son, but he gave him up for us all. So too will he graciously give us all things. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect, Paul says. It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Jesus Christ is the one who died. More than that, my friend, he is the one who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us right now. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for this love, Lord.
The